creator or some sort of inventor of things, you have to kind of be willing to go into a place of delusion, because it's not there's not always a function for or a reason for what we do. We have to put aside logic sometimes in order to go to the weirder parts of our brain. But I think my work is about like dancing around that delusion. When I started making sculptures where I was going to be buying the things I needed, I think it began with where it was just the things I liked. It was things that amused me because of their dysfunctional kind of purpose. I didn't know what they were used for, but I'd find this like a relic of a thing, a handle from something that I didn't know what it was for, and it puzzled me, but I was attracted to its color. And I largely pulled things that were formally just appealing to me.
Does this work? Chris, do you know if this works?
It's the guys right here.
Okay, I'll ask him. Yeah. Cool.
What I'm interested in isn't necessarily about me touching that object or like my personal history with that object, but that object was touched before I ever found it. And that touch is embedded in things, in all things. And locating what that kind of, what is lingering, you know, because of that touch.
There's always good stuff here. Yeah, I mean. Or you buy something that you didn't know you needed until you see it, you know.
When I'm looking at these objects, I want to know how can one embed themselves or like attach themselves to something that's so cold? And what do we do to like to have some sort of like personal experience with that thing? You know, you buy a shirt off a rack and it's just any shirt, but eventually that shirt becomes your shirt. And where is that moment that it goes from being any old shirt to your shirt or your pen or your bucket? And there is a moment there. And how do you illustrate that? You know, how do I put it then in a gallery and say, and like kind of create that sort of aura or like that touch that's like an unseen touch around that. And I still, to this day, when I buy things, I don't buy the things I like, I buy the things that confuse me or the things that I dislike and want to learn to love in a way, or I want to learn to understand. And that is sort of where the work, like the objects kind of begin to have a story. Typically, a lot of the things I do collect or buy, and they never get used right away. Like they sit in my studio for a really long time. And what I want them to be, or what I think I want them for when I buy them, is that would be the notion of the conqueror. If I bought the thing and used it immediately in my work, I would be the one that's telling it what to do. When I bring them to the studio, the transformation of an object occurs when it's just sitting with other objects. And it loses that immediate like lust for the object, or it loses that like immediate humor. You know, so if it strikes me funny, I don't want it to be a one-liner. So I don't want it to be a cheap trick. So I have faith that it'll reveal its true intention, or that I'll see beyond the surface of it.
Thank you.
you know, I think of Magritte and his pipe painting quite a bit. And that sort of, or Duchamp, of course. And really, like, the difficulty with images and icons and how it's really hard to undo them. And my studio is filled with nothing but iconic things, you know, or things that are really loaded with taste, and they're very tactile and they're bright and they're garish in some ways. And so they, like, get an immediate response from me and other people. And it takes time, you know, to get beyond that pop. I've always been interested in Fassbender's film, The Bitter Tears of Petra von Kant. And in the very end of that movie, this woman is waiting for her lover to call her back, and she doesn't call her. And there's something really inexplicable about love, and that, like, moment when what you want, you don't get. And in this object triumph, I felt like I finally got what I wanted out of these chairs. It was a kind of, like, acceptance of, like, this object, this cell phone, not being the vessel that'll take you away or transport you. And when you understand that you can't put all of your hopes into objects, and that they will never necessarily, like, take you away. And for me, having to cope with this, like, phone as the thing that is, a lot of times or moments in my life, I've really wanted something from a phone, as we do still. You know, for Petra, I think she wanted something that wasn't really within her grasp, you know, and she was delusional. And so she would always, there was sort of, she was setting herself up for failure. And I think the acceptance of, or learning to let go of something, you know, or see that, like, something has passed and it's important to notice it and, you know, absorb an object into your life. It's now someone else's, you know, it was someone else's object, now it's mine. And learning to, like, let that go or also put it back into the world is important, an important part of my practice. I'd like to think I have no taste at all, and that my taste is forever changing, and therefore there's really no taste. So if I'm like a sponge, you know, I'm just constantly on the level. I'm willing to, like, absorb as much as I need and get rid of what I don't without any kind of prejudice, just as long as I'm participating. And I like to just see, I like to believe that, like, intuition is planning, and not knowing is exciting. And if I don't know what the plan for an object is, there'll be more chance and more fear, but then the discovery will be greater. Thought of the objects as the objects. I've spoken about them as props, it was more of a conceptual prop, and I would talk about these as in terms of characters or props for a stage, but there was no film. Like, the film was just in my mind, or if I would create an installation or some sort of tableau, I would say, this is a film, and you're in the film, but there is no, you'll never see it moving, you know, the only people that will see it moving are the people behind you. As I'm making videos now, I like to enact those sculptures that I do make and put them in the videos, just to reinstate that, in fact, these are objects, you know, that are part of a bigger world, you know, and to remind people that it's not just an object for sale, but that it is an object that has history and kinship with other things within my studio and has direct connections, you know, to a language that's broad and bigger than just one thing. The first thing I learned to draw. My mom taught us how to draw. She drew pictures of her coworkers and would draw pictures of our family caricatures. Very like comic, early comic strip style, sort of like Dr. Seuss or Shel Silverstein. And so she would teach us how to draw like basic cartoon characters and thought that that was maybe like a way to, I don't know what it was. I think she just knew that it was important to draw and create. And so I learned to draw Snoopy. So that's like the first like art I remember thinking was art, you know, like pen to paper or pencil to paper. But then after that, the second thing I think of when I think about art is the Sistine Chapel. My family was really religious, is still really religious, Catholic, Roman Catholic. And that was always considered sort of like the highest, you know, painting that had ever been made, or the most profound. And so I grew up looking at that painting and studying that painting over and over again. We had a poster of it in my house somewhere, I think in the basement. And I would just look at that and look at, and I was really interested in all of the sort of like the references to other people in culture at the time that Michelangelo had like referred to, like the Pope that he made the devil and himself as like a melted skin. And so I remember studying that and that being sort of like the, like creating myths out of that, out of those figures, even if I didn't really know the stories behind them, I did look at them and kind of made up fantasies about them. And that was kind of like my cartoons a bit. My parents bought my grandparents a ticket to Rome to see this painting when I was really young. And I remember that being a group Christmas gift that they, like all of my aunts and uncles bought our grandparents this ticket to see this painting. And it was really just to go see this painting. And then my grandfather coming back, and he was really an emotional guy and really sweet man, and kind of talking about seeing the painting, the experience of seeing that painting. And that kind of just storytelling where there was so much like sentiment and sweetness about speaking about something that's just a painting, it really like shapes how you think, you know, because it was more than anything. It was more than the architecture, more than, we weren't talking about TV, we weren't talking about, I mean, they spoke about music in the same way, but there was something about talking about paintings and that particular painting that really like, you know, It stayed with me. I think I wanted to do something that important, or I wanted to be able to do that too, you know, and kind of move people in the same way that like my grandfather was moved and my mom was moved.
Avant un voyage, on doit exorciser sa peur pour franchir le seuil de l'inconnu. Les choses stupides que vos amis vous disent, les discours de votre famille, tout doit être jeté comme des outils obsolètes et de nouveaux outils doivent être emmagasinés.
I didn't go to an arts high school, and my parents, my mom did like to draw, but their understanding of contemporary art was very limited or practically non-existent. I didn't even know about Andy Warhol, I don't think, until I was in college, maybe, or like, you know, because for me, like, my main goal was to work for Disney, and so I looked at cartoonists more than, I didn't know what contemporary sculpture was or painting. I mean, I understood you know, what like Giotto's painting was, but I didn't understand what Rauschenberg was. And I think that because my grandfather grew up in that time where abstract expressionists came in, he saw Picasso and Pollock and all of this kind of like turn, like a kind of, he saw that as like anti-aesthetic and vulgar, you know, and anti-human and misogynist. He didn't like it at all, so he spoke down about all of that, so I just refused to look at it as well. And which is funny to me, but that, like, that really was his feelings. He thought it was like bastardizing goodness or good art or craft. And so I think when I finally went to New York for animation, I went to the School of Visual Arts there, and it took me, you know, about a year to really, like, I got there and I was like, oh my God, this is, maybe I don't want Disney anymore. Maybe that's not, like, you know, it was really wild up there. And I think I grew up really quick when I went there, you know, seeing a Warhol and seeing Klaus Oldenburg in museums, like that really like changed my brain. At the time, the Sensation Show was kind of hitting New York, and so there was all the YBAs that were starting to work. And I think being aware of the collision between my religious beliefs at the time and you know, the sort of bigger art world critiquing it, and sort of put me up against a wall. Like, I had to make a choice, or I was like aware that like what I, this kind of shell that I had, or a very sheltered life that I had had, was kind of unraveling a bit. And I started to, I think at that moment, seek out like what other ways like people could express themselves and express the things that they believed in. Which is, I guess, part of growing up, but I didn't really know that. You know, I kind of was in a bubble where I love cartoons, and cartoons made me happy. And I wanted to be someone who worked in that way. And then when I realized there was something else that I could do, maybe to express a truer self or my truer desires, I went after it. I think, like any kind of system of beliefs, you're given a set of laws or a set of systems, and then you have to adapt them to make the most sense for yourself. At the time, I was not out, so I think also coming into terms with my own sexuality was part of this like awakening and readjustment. And art was like sex in some ways, you know, because it was something that I wasn't exposed to. And so I think I like equated them to be the same, you know, and I just like went for it because I was young and in my 20s and wanted to absorb as much as I could. So I did, with images and objects that people were making in this like really big city, which was New York. And seeing something as simple as like a big hamburger made by Klaus Oldenburg, like a vinyl, to me was like pure sex. Like I was just like in love with everything about it. And all of the kind of like things that it implied without being that thing. And I love that dance. And I think that kind of shaped, I think what I take from my religious upbringing is that we knew how to, we definitely know, you know, we have a very like good sense of what it means to be dramatic or melodramatic, and we understand like stages and like opera, and also how to tell a story using symbols and codes and a certain kind of metaphor. So for years, I kind of developed this world where the diner that you go to eat was my church, or was like my safe haven, and that ketchup was the thing that held it all together. And so I was very, you know, there was a very fraught moment in my life where I was torn between wanting to please my family and be close with them, wanting to understand myself and what I wanted as a, you know, sexual person or just a person who had needs. And then where, you know, also what I would do with the rest of my life, like what my job would be. And so as I would sit in the diner and kind of just draw and draw and draw, that became sort of like the place I was the most comfortable with myself, where I could just invent a world in a drawing book, and the things around me in this environment became like my friends or my family. And I really, really did feel that ketchup was something I could rely on, that I had no stability in my life at the time, but any diner I went to, there was a bottle of ketchup and a salt and a pepper shaker and a sugar and a cup of coffee. And I believe that like that consistency were the people that I needed to rely on. And so that way of telling a story through stuff relied a lot on tension. And I was pushing up against like the things I couldn't say by saying them through these other things that seemed more palatable. You know, I couldn't necessarily talk about sex explicitly, and I thought it was maybe more exciting to kind of keep that tension, you know, keep the clothes on in some ways and delve into something that was more about fantasy. You know, ketchup is ketchup, sure, but it's also red, you know, and wet and moving and can be passionate. And trying to like take one thing and propose that it's something else, that this like thing that I've always understood, even if that thing was me, you know, at the time, and understanding it as one thing and realizing that maybe the mask was being pulled away, or that my resolute kind of beliefs were changing, how to accommodate that. I think that being in Philadelphia, you know, being in the studio, which is clearly sort of far away from a lot of things, I have a sort of freedom to dream and not be in a rush. We have so much access to things, and what do you do when you have that much access? I choose to sort of be inaccessible. You know, I don't use the internet very much at all. I'm kind of like a, you know, very much an analog kind of guy. I still like to make things with my hands. I still think about touch. You know, I still think about family and, you know, what I'm doing in some days feels like just completely like a weird world that I'm creating, you know. I think of it as anthropology. You know, just being invested in culture and analyzing it. I'm doing this and creating this world so that, like, when people do enter it and see it, you know, they can see what things look like when they're turned on their heads, and then they begin to think or rethink what they've always, like, you know, the ground that they've always, like, stood on and considered to be the one true thing. And I think my work is a combination of Disney, you know, and Warner Brothers cartoons, with equal parts, you know, Warhol and Mike Kelly and Bob Gober and Klaus Oldenburg. These people have a really firm grasp on their worlds, you know, and creating worlds that are completely made of their own strange devices. And somehow their worlds, you know, become magnets and pull people in because they propose such strange things, and it doesn't, you know, a world made entirely of Campbell soup and Marilyn Monroe doesn't make any sense at first. And then you see sort of like that this kind of disparate pairing creates its own systems. And I like to believe that I have a similar kind of logic when making work.
I remember you well in the Chelsea Hotel. You were talking so brave and so sweet, giving me head on the unmade bed while the limousines wait in the street. Those were the reason that was New York. We were running for the money and the flesh.
I guess stemming from this idea about creating some large world in which Ketchup was the star, I thought I could continue to do that and sort of speak to the problems or the things I was noticing in the world, you know, and how people were, I don't know, the different relationships that people were creating in the circles of friends I had, or just, it started very intimately, so it was more like about these one-to-one problems, you know. If something was happening in my world, I would try to make a way to not illustrate that with stuff, but there was definitely some kind of direct, you know, staging where I would remove all the people from the tableau I was making with this stuff, but instead of me it would be an IKEA lamp, or instead of a good friend of mine it would be a stuffed animal that was opened up on the ground. And so I think thinking about objects as stand-ins for people then became a way for me to understand that objects are just another kind of language that we can pair together to create these sentences that turn into poetry.
I don't mean to suggest that I loved you the best. I can't keep track of each fallen robin. I remember you well in the Chelsea Hotel. That's all, I don't even think of you that often.